today and for Dr. Koiken for the invitation to speak. So as eloquently stated there, my name is Osman Ahmed. I go by Oz. I'm an interventional radiologist, and I have the pleasure of talking about part of what I do and what I love to do. So we're going to talk about the interventional treatments for liver metastases. So I first kind of want to start out by just explaining what interventional radiology is, because we're a little bit of a kind of a closet specialty. I would say 99.9% of my friends and family don't know exactly what I do. So, and it's part of it is because it's very hard to explain what we do. But what interventional radiology is it's a specialty where physicians use imaging to perform minimally invasive procedures. So we're actually trained as radiologists. So I spent 4 years sitting in a dark room learning how to read images. But then I spent the last year of my training learning how to use that imaging to guide wires and catheters to different parts of the body. And just like people have probably heard of their cardiologists treating their heart attacks with stents to open up blood vessels, we do the exact same thing for pretty much every other organ in the body. And so why is this important? It's important because in a minimally invasive fashion, us as interventional radiologists, we have the ability to treat and potentially cure some cancers. And it, what it's really spawned is it's almost a subset of what we do, a new field of medicine that we call interventional oncology. And what are the benefits of interventional oncology? The benefits are because what we do is very subspecialized and very focused to where we're treating, we're able to maximize the ratio of the kill to the tumor, but without the kind of the systemic side effects of you know, systemic therapies, for example. So also because everything's minimally invasive, usually just a puncture in the groin or a needle directly into the tumor, I would say 99% of our procedures are outpatient or 23-hour observation procedures. And typically it's usually just one time that you'll have this procedure, or sometimes it's twice. And it's also very cost-effective. You could imagine it's, you know, you're in the hospital and you're out right away. And it's also very personalized. So everything that we do, the way we design our treatments, the way that we order the doses, everything is very specific to the specific patient and the specific amount of tumor that they have. So unfortunately, not everything is great. There's also downsides to what we do. So targeted therapies also mean that I can't treat everything in the body. So it's very specific to special organs that we can treat, and we'll talk about some of those. Unfortunately, not all patients are candidates for the treatments that we do. Again, if you have widespread disease, I can't go in and pick out every single organ. I can usually only do one or two. And then just like anything that's new, we really don't know the true benefits, the true risks, the true everything about them. So without further ado, what are the treatments? So the way that I kind of classify what we're able to do is we divide it up into two types of methods that we treat tumors. One is called transarterial. So that's going to be, we go through a blood vessel to the tumors that, the blood vessels that feed the tumor. And then the other is what we call percutaneous ablation. So we just take a needle and directly put it into the tumor. So what are transarterial interventions? The majority, I would say the vast majority of the transarterial interventions that we do are going to be in the liver. Why the liver? The liver is a very unique organ in the body in the sense that it has two blood vessels that supply it. And interestingly enough, it has a hepatic artery, which tumors in the liver derive almost all of their blood flow from the hepatic artery. And then the portal vein, which also interestingly enough, the majority of normal liver derives its blood from. So you could imagine if you go into the hepatic artery, find the blood vessels that feed the tumor and embolize them or shut them, those blood vessels down, you can hopefully kill the majority of the tumor and spare the rest of the normal liver. All right. So people always ask, you know, well, what are those treatments that you can do? And we'll say the words like radioembolization or Y90. We'll say chemoembolization, or we'll say bland embolization. The concept is exactly the same for all three of those procedures, meaning we take a small tube on the average of less than 1 millimeter in size into the blood vessels that feed the tumor, just like this graphic illustrates. Once you get the catheter parked where you want it to be, essentially as close to the tumor as possible, you can inject three different things. You can inject just bland particles or just like beads or, that have nothing on them. and those beads will go into the tumor and plug up the blood vessels to them, and we call that bland embolization. You can inject those beads also with a mixture of chemotherapy. So that combination is called chemoembolization. Alternatively, you can take beads that are actually radioactive, that are essentially radiation beads, and inject those, and that's called radioembolization. So the catheter is in the same exact spot. You can inject three different things, and it's called three different procedures. How we choose those things is probably well beyond the scope of my talk today, but that's sort of what we do. So here's an example. So the red is the hepatic artery feeding the tumor, and then the blue is the portal vein sort of feeding the normal liver. This is what we see. This is a CT angiogram. This is actually directly taken with a catheter in the hepatic artery, or the artery that goes to the liver. And just like you see that big kind of blood vessel going straight to that tumor. This is actually how I see it on my angiogram. So this is an angiogram, and essentially that's just what I just showed you. But what I'm injecting is just dye into the artery. So all I can see is really the arteries. I can't see anything else. But as you can see, we follow that big kind of enlarged blood vessel, follow that to the tumor, and then we're going to do exactly what I just talked about, where we're going to inject, whether it's beads, chemo, or radiation. So I'm just going to focus on one thing, which is the radioembolization, which is sort of our newest treatment that we offer. You'll hear a bunch of different terms for it. You'll hear radioembolization. You'll hear Y90. You'll also hear selective internal radiation therapy. What it is, as I mentioned, they're tiny radioactive spheres or beads that we inject into the tumor from the arteries that feed it. These beads only emit a radiation field of about 1 millimeter, so they're very, very, very targeted, and they last for up to 2 weeks. And you're able to give very, very, very high doses of radiation without a lot of the side effects of giving it systemically, from the outside. And then again, this is a single outpatient procedure. So just a few examples of a Y90. This is a 76-year-old female with a metastatic neuroendocrine tumor of the pancreas and had carcinoid syndrome. And similar to some of the prior presentations, you know, as you can see, you see these CT scans with, you know, an impressive amount of tumors. And again, neuroendocrine is one of the tumors that for us is relatively nice to treat because those are very hungry. They get a lot of blood supply to them. So we trick those tumors by injecting directly into the artery. And this is another patient, similar, but kind of easier to see the tumors. And this is the angiogram. And again, very hypervascular, very dense. The blush is very dense. That means that what we inject, those tumors are going to be like vacuum cleaners. They're going to suck up the beads. And this is 2 years later. You can see that the tumors are essentially dead. They're no longer those bright light bulbs. They're the opposite. The light bulbs have burned out. Similar, the second patient, also similar findings. I'll kind of finish by talking about percutaneous ablation, which is something that I and also Dr. Coy can do. The way that we do it is directly through the skin. So what we do is we either use a CT scan or an ultrasound machine, and we guide a needle directly into the tumor. And depending on what we do, just like the transarterial therapies, depending on what type of needle we put in there, we can do a different types of things. So our main types of ablation that we do are we call thermal ablation. So I can put a needle into a tumor, and then I can do one of three things usually. I can freeze it, and we call that cryoablation. I can burn it, and we call that either microwave or radio frequency ablation, or we can electrocute it, and we call that irreversible electroporation. Again, probably outside the scope of a 10-minute talk today, but happy to talk with anyone offline if they have questions about how we choose what we choose. And this is just an example. So the image on the left, you can see this is a kind of a tumor in the central part of the liver here, the caudate lobe, and this is a single probe needle that goes into the tumor. And then you can see post-ablation that the tumor is dead. The nice thing about ablation is we know right away that if the tumor is dead or not, and we can check that. So in conclusion, IR, or interventional radiology, is an exciting field of medicine that can perform minimally invasive procedures for most patients with cancer, but especially patients with neuroendocrine tumor. These tumors, like I said, these treatments are designed to be highly targeted and individualized to minimize side effects and also maximize the tumor kill. And most common treatments performed are in the liver, where tumors can be killed both through the arteries and directly through with needles. All right, thank you.